The Brion McClanahan Show, episode 174.
Are you ready to think locally and act locally? Welcome to the Brion McClanahan Show.
Welcome back to the Brion McClanahan Show. Glad to have you back on the program. Very glad to be here. Don't forget to follow me on Twitter at Brion McClanahan. Like my Facebook page at Brion McClanahan. And, of course, subscribe to my YouTube page at Brion McClanahan. You don't want to find all those things, just go to my webpage, brionmcclanahan.com. You've got all my social media buttons at the top of the page. Give me an email address, and I'll give you a free ebook, Forgotten Founders, and a free audiobook read by yours truly of the same title. You can also support the Brion McClanahan Show by going to brionmcclanahan.com/support. You can throw a few pennies my way, help keep the lights on, help keep the podcast going. And you can always support the Brion McClanahan Show by going to mcclanahanacademy.com, where it's always free to enroll. And I have four courses for sale there and another one coming up this month. So pre-orders will be available this month. The course won't be released till October, but only those who are enrolled in McClanahan Academy are going to get the pre-order deal. Everyone else won't get that. So you're going to want to enroll to get that deal and get this course. It is on the Constitution. It's a Constitution class that you're going to want because it's different from anything I've done on that topic before. And it's going to be the course that will help you understand that document in its entirety. So get on out to mcclanahanacademy.com and enroll. You can also support the Brion McClanahan Show by going to Learn True History, TRUEHistory.com. That is my affiliate link for Liberty Classroom. Just go there, learntruehistory.com, and you can get a membership to Liberty Classroom. Really is the best bang for the buck on the web. So you're going to want to do that. And finally, if you like the Brion McClanahan Show, go on out to iTunes and leave a review. The more reviews, the better. The more reviews, it bumps up the list there so you can show your support for Brion McClanahan Show and leave a good review and more people will listen to the show. Okay, all of that said, let's talk about the topic for the week. And this is one that I knew was going to stir a lot of controversy when I did it and people were not going to like me for it, but I wanted to write it anyways. And it's an article I wrote for the Abbeville Institute website a couple of weeks ago entitled The Last Republican President, and LouRockwell.com picked it up. And I think I've received more negative emails off of that piece than anything I've done in a long time. Now, I also received some positive email out of it, and because people got what I was trying to say, but this actually piggybacks on another email that I received from a listener who said, would you do a show on what the founding generation thought of the presidency? What did they think the president should be? Well, I mean, to answer that email very quickly, I wrote a whole book on that entitled Nine Presidents Who Screwed Up America. And there's a chapter, the first chapter is on the founder's executive and what the founding generation thought. But I'll go through that briefly in this podcast. But I want to talk about what Americans overall, for most of American history, wanted out of the executive branch. And I did this in a way that I knew this was going to be something that people were either going to like or they're really going to hate. And that's because I decided I was going to use Jimmy Carter as an example of a man the founding generation, at least the Jeffersonians in the founding generation and beyond, would recognize. Now, if you go up and do a man on the street and say, hey, who's the worst president in American history? Right now, you might get the people on the left, oh, Donald Trump is terrible. That guy's awful. And then if you ask somebody on the quote-unquote right, they're going to either say, oh, gosh, it's Obama. But before Obama, it had to be Jimmy Carter. So you're going to get that response. Jimmy Carter. And I'll never forget, I had after I wrote the Nine Presidents book, I had lots of people, hey, did you put Jimmy Carter in there? No, I didn't put Jimmy Carter in there. And some of the other people I omitted were also, did you put John F. Kennedy as a guy who tried to save America? No, I didn't put John F. Kennedy as a guy who tried to save America. That would be ridiculous. Or did you put Ronald Reagan as a guy who tried to save America? No, I didn't, because Ronald Reagan, and I should do a podcast, an episode sometime just on Kennedy and Reagan and talk about why I omitted them from the book. And I'm going to do one on Carter today and why I didn't put him as one of the guys who screwed up America. So that this is going to answer that question. And I hope it does it in a way that you understand. First of all, most of the vitriol that came from this piece was not from people, I think in many ways, it was from people that didn't actually read it. And if they did, they didn't read it very carefully, because there is such this ingrained perception of Carter, particularly if you're a quote-unquote conservative, that you just have to hate the guy. It's because Conservative Inc. has told you Jimmy Carter is one of the worst presidents in American history. I didn't think it could get any worse than Carter. Then we had Obama. But, of course, they skip right over George W. Bush and George H.W. Bush, who were awful. And there are no sacred cows in my Nine Presidents book. If you haven't read that book, you can get it for like $12 now, hardback, on Amazon. And if you haven't read it, you need to, because I slay all the sacred cows. I even go after George Washington in that book. So I wasn't shy or afraid of taking a controversial position, and not putting Jimmy Carter in there, I think, was a controversial position. So talking about Jimmy Carter in a way that would be positive, I knew was going to create some ripples in the water, so to speak. So a lot of it, though, was ideological. How can you say Jimmy Carter was a good guy? He's terrible. He's a phony. He did terrible things in foreign policy. The interest was up. Or maybe we could just quote Hank Williams Jr. The interest is up and the stock market's down. You had all that issue in the late 1970s. Certainly. But was all that Carter's fault? But the point of the piece wasn't to defend Jimmy Carter's policies. In fact, I said that. Some of that was, of course, perception rather than policy. It was people didn't like Jimmy Carter as an individual. Yeah, the interest was up in the late 1970s. Why? Because Carter appointed Volcker as chairman of the Federal Reserve, and Volcker was going to stop the runaway inflation of the 1970s, which was caused by the Great Society and having to come off a precious metal standard during the Nixon administration. So that led to years of runaway inflation. So Volcker comes in and says, we're going to stop this. We're going to raise interest rates to a point where, yes, you had mortgages. People couldn't get a mortgage for near 20% interest. And that's awful. I mean, there's no doubt about it. But why was that the case? They don't go back to the real cause of the problem. They're looking at a symptom of the disease, not the disease itself. One person said, well, how can you like Carter? He told us not to use credit cards. Gee, that's pretty good advice, I think. You know, not to use credit cards. That's some pretty solid financial advice. maybe you don't want to do that. That's a bad idea long term for your financial health. So these are the kind of attacks I was getting. How can you say Jimmy Carter's great? His foreign policy was awful. As I said in the piece, his foreign policy was a mixed bag at best. But then one of the arguments was, well, Jimmy Carter, he got rid of the Shah of Iran. The Shah actually came to the United States after that and lived here. And Carter, again, was fighting a symptom of the disease. The disease itself was the CIA in 1953. So, this is not Carter's fault. The Iranian situation was something Carter was thrown into because of Cold War politics. So, to blame Carter for some of these things is just ridiculously stupid. But not just that. To sit there and say that I don't know about these things about Jimmy Carter, that there are problems with Jimmy Carter's administration, absolutely. To think that I'm defending... And the other thing was, how can you call Jimmy Carter a Republican? He was a Democrat, and that was my favorite. I got a lot of those. Jimmy Carter's not a Republican. He was a Democrat. I've been a Republican my entire life. And to say Jimmy Carter is a Republican is to just spit in the face of Republicans. Well, I didn't call him a Republican with a capital R. In fact, the piece on Abbeville Institute had the last Republican with a lowercase r, president, because that's what I was going for with Jimmy Carter. So let's talk about what made Jimmy Carter the last Republican with a lowercase r, president. We haven't had one since. At all. In fact, from the Carter administration forward, what we've had is an elected king. And what we've also had is Americans throw in their lot with this idea that the president is going to change everything in America. Jimmy Carter was the last individual who really had a position that the presidency should be downgraded, that the Congress and the states were going to do things to try to change the government. Of course, Carter was working as well. He was a micromanager. I mean, this guy was not simply a hands-off executive. In fact, you could make the case he firmly was hands-on, but he was doing some things symbolically that were, he was trying to downgrade the office. And I think that's the most Jeffersonian thing about him. You can go back to Thomas Jefferson and look at what Jefferson did in 1801 when he assumed office and some of the ceremonial things he did to make the presidency seem less important, even though Jefferson was violating the Constitution like crazy in his second term. But at least he viewed the Constitution as something you had to wrestle with. I mean, Carter didn't really do that. I'm not going to make a case that Carter was someone who was a constitutionalist. He wasn't. But Carter was at least trying to downgrade the office of the presidency, which is something that Americans, particularly in the founding generation, but even moving forward, wanted. They didn't want an elected king at all. But that's exactly what we have today. Look at how, and the piece that sparked this was a little piece in the Washington Post, of all places, that talked about Jimmy Carter as the uncelebrity president. No, it's Jimmy Carter as the non-elected monarchy. That was the point of that. And again, that whole there was some good information in that piece, but they missed the point again because it's the Washington Post. They just don't know what they're doing. So Carter, when he leaves office, he goes back to Plains, Georgia, and lives in the same house that he's lived in since the 1960s. It's a two-bedroom ranch house. The last president to really do something like that was Calvin Coolidge. And even Coolidge moved out of his home into a bigger home eventually. But the last president to go home to a little place, just kind of a quiet retired life, was Calvin Coolidge. Think about that. Calvin Coolidge, as I say in the beginning, was probably the last authentic president in the way Jimmy Carter was. Coolidge was a man of New England. He was a man of a place, and he stayed that same man his entire time in Washington, and then when he went back to New England. He stayed the same guy. Calvin Coolidge was no different. I mean, here one of my favorite Calvin Coolidge stories is when Coolidge gets the news that Warren Harding has died. He comes downstairs. He's woken up, comes downstairs, takes the oath of office, and goes back upstairs and goes to bed. He's on vacation, goes to bed. Okay. Doesn't worry about it. It was not some big, you know, he's going to have some big press conference right then and try to have a situation where he's going to have the media involved and he's got to get out. No, he'll take care of that tomorrow. That's okay. And then he travels back to D.C. Somebody's robbing his hotel room. He gives the guy a few bucks and tells him to go on his way. Doesn't tell the story for years. I mean, this is Calvin Coolidge, a very authentic individual. For whatever you thought about Calvin Coolidge, now a lot of people hated Calvin Coolidge. So H.L. Mencken really hated Calvin Coolidge. Didn't like Warren Harding either. Thought they were both idiots. But Calvin Coolidge, in fact, when Mencken had a begrudging respect for Coolidge after Coolidge's administration, but and Coolidge, if you look at some of the things he was trying to do to heal the wounds of the war and reconciliation, and I'm very interested in this topic of reconciliation, Coolidge was a good president in that way, and of course all the trimming down of the general government, all that kind of stuff, and we get into policy too, and he's one of the presidents who tried to save America in my Nine Presidents book. So I do like Calvin Coolidge. But Jimmy Carter was doing some things that were interesting in that way. So he goes back home. In fact, when he lands in Georgia, takes what was Marine One, now it's not Marine One, but takes a helicopter back to Georgia. And he lands in Plains. The band's playing Dixie. And they play Dixie the whole time at one point. Just playing Dixie. It's great. Big Southern kind of festival. It's a grand time. Jimmy Carter wanted to go back to being a farmer. He couldn't because his peanut farm was in so much debt. He kind of put that aside during the presidency. It was in so much debt, he had to sell it. But he had to go back to doing something. So he decided he was going to write books. And he was going to paint. And he was going to make furniture. And of course, he has the lowest pension of any president, any former president. He spends the least on Secret Service detail. He started doing humanitarian work. He basically went home and got out of the limelight. Every now and then, Jimmy Carter pops up, somebody asks him a question. He's been on the news recently criticizing Donald Trump, and I don't really care about that. I mean, I don't expect him to do anything else. To expect him to do something else is to be disappointed. But he wrote a little book a few years back entitled An Hour Before Daylight. It's the only agrarian manifesto that's ever been written by a president except for Thomas Jefferson's Notes on the State of Virginia. That was it. Two people were farmers. Ben Jones said that, Carter as a Jeffersonian, he'd go out and plant something and write a poem about it. mean, this is a man who was firmly committed to being a non-elected monarchy, or a non-elected monarch, I should say. He walked to his inaugural, same thing Thomas Jefferson did. He symbolically downgraded the office. He carried his luggage onto the plane. Now, I know the luggage was empty. People, well, you know the luggage is empty? Of course I know it was empty. That's okay. It's the symbol of it all. The people's president. The man who's not the elected king. Isn't that kind of refreshing? And this is exactly what Americans expected out of the executive office from the time it was created, all the way up until the 20th century. Americans didn't want an elected king. This is why Franklin Roosevelt, after standing for election four times, why we had a constitutional amendment restricting that. This is why George Washington, his two-term president, was there. Because you step down, you do not become an elected king. Washington could have been an elected king. You don't do it. You step down and you go home. That was George Washington's gift to America. You go home. He went back to Mount Vernon, became a farmer again, died very shortly thereafter, but became a farmer. You retire. You get rid of everything. You even, at one point, and of course this is before the presidency, but he got rid of his vestry position in the local church. You get rid of that. You don't go out and be someone who capitalizes on your fame. You don't become an elected monarch. They didn't fight a war for nearly 8 years against the British to have another elected, or have an elected monarch, or have another monarchical system in America. Now, Alexander Hamilton wanted it, and for all the things that Hamilton was, I think, and of course I've written, as you know, probably I've written a book on how Hamilton screwed up America, getting out to the year anniversary of that book, and I'll probably do something with that next week. If you haven't bought that, you should. But the fact is, Hamilton was prescient when he said, you know what, we're going to get an elected king, you might as well go for it now. I will give Hamilton credit as being a visionary in what America was going to become, if only because I think that's what he wanted, and that's how Hamilton screwed up America. But he said, we're going to get it, might as well go for it now, and he's been proven correct. We've gotten an elected king. We don't call it that, but we certainly have an elected king. Look at the amount of ceremony, pomp, and circumstance, the way that the president is coddled and protected, and the executive mansion has become something of a palace. Now, to someone like Trump, who's used to higher standard of living, that's not the case. But to someone like Obama, or even Jimmy Carter could have been this way. I mean, this was an upgrade. I mean, the Obama family didn't come from a whole lot. I mean, they were doing well. They were upper middle class, certainly. But to go to the executive mansion was something else. Or maybe even Harry Truman, a middle class guy, to go to the executive mansion was something else. And this was a real upgrade. The Bushes, you know, George H.W. Bush didn't come. I mean, man had money. Same thing with George W. Bush. Ronald Reagan had money. So, you know, perhaps it was, you know, a similar kind of lifestyle. The Clintons, absolutely an upgrade. This is why they stole all the China off Air Force One. Certainly an upgrade for the Clintons. So you go from those individuals, Clintons, the Obamas, the Trumans, and it's an upgrade. But Jimmy Carter, even though it could have been an upgrade for Jimmy Carter, didn't look at it that way. He wanted to ensure that that very folksy kind of middle class stamp was put on the executive mansion. The same thing Thomas Jefferson did in 1801. He answered the door himself. Somebody said, you know, well, Jimmy Carter wasn't presidential for doing these things. Was it presidential for Thomas Jefferson to open the door himself to the executive mansion? Was that presidential? Or how about the fact that Jefferson worked in his bathrobe around the executive mansion? How about that? Or that he abolished official state dinners and just had kind of a potluck. You just help yourself. Was that presidential? I mean, these are questions that you have to ask yourself. Or what do we want out of the executive office? Do we want a king? So when you go back and you look at the Philadelphia Convention, when the idea of a single executive was proposed, the convention sat in stunned silence. Nobody knew what to say after that. I mean, we just fought a war. Thousands of men died fighting a war against executive tyranny, essentially. I mean, the Declaration was an indictment of King George III, just like the English Bill of Rights was an indictment of Charles, Charles II, essentially. But the king itself, the monarchy itself, so are we going to have that here? And that was a debate that the members of the Philadelphia Convention had for a very long period of time. Do we really want this? And if we're going to have it, how are we going to check the executive's power? And when you look at the state constitutions, this is something that's going to be in my constitution course. When you look at the state constitutions, for example, the 1780 Constitution for Massachusetts, the executive is there, but the powers of the executive are circumscribed by the document, and the legislature has all the authority, for the most part. The executive's there to execute the laws, but not much else. That is the key to understanding this suspicion of the executive branch. You look at the Articles of Confederation, no executive. And I know people say, well, yes, we've had presidents before George Washington, president of the Congress. No, that wasn't an American president. I know people say this. It's just, I've already done a podcast episode on that. That's just a bad argument. So we didn't have a president until George Washington, not in the way that we have a president today. But the convention sat in stunned silence, and then they discussed this, and ultimately what they wanted to do is give the president very limited powers. Now, you look at Article 2 of the Constitution, and there's not a whole lot there. There isn't. In fact, it's pretty vague on what the president can do, but the president's powers are circumscribed by the Senate, which is the states. The president can't do anything without Senate approval when it comes to foreign policy or appointments. He can't. The president doesn't have an absolute veto. The president has to ask Congress for a declaration of war. In other words, the president doesn't have power over either the purse or the sword or over appointments unilaterally. But you see, that's the dirty little secret. The president is not the most powerful individual according to the Constitution. The Congress is the most powerful branch of government other than the states. But this was the founder's executive. So when George Washington becomes president, he's very cautious in his implementation of executive powers. He understands Americans don't want an elected king, and so he tries not to do that. When you look at then John Adams was also attempting at times to be restrained in his use of power, though we can question some of his policy decisions. Adams wasn't a monarch. And I know the Jeffersonians essentially called him that. You know, they called out John Adams and they said, look, this guy advocates a monarchy. Just look at what he said about the Constitution. He's a monarchist, closet monarchist. Now, Hamilton was. I'm not so certain Adams was. But certainly one of the reasons why Jefferson won in 1801, why Americans decided that Jefferson should be president, is that he was an individual who was not interested in monarchy, and he certainly put that stamp on the executive branch. And we had that Jeffersonian vision of the executive branch all the way up into the 20th century. And I'll give you some examples. When Martin Van Buren was running for president against William Henry Harrison in 1840, one of the charges against Van Buren is that he lived in the palace and ate off of golden spoons. And that Harrison, the way that Harrison was portrayed, and this is the first election that you have campaign slogans and songs, it's the first one where you really have two conventions that get into it, two modern political machines that get into the process. And so Harrison is portrayed as a man of the people. It's the log cabin and hard cider campaign. And William Henry Harrison lives in a log cabin, drinks hard cider, just like you. But you've got Martin Van Buren riding in royal coaches and eating off of golden spoons and living in the palace. What do you want? Do you want a king or do you want a man of the people? You see, and Harrison wins. Harrison wins. One of the critiques of Andrew Jackson was that he was King Andrew. This is what he was called in South Carolina. He was King Andrew. He had too much power. And people rallied against that. The Whigs. The Whig Party was formed because they thought the presidency was getting too much power. And when John Tyler becomes president, this is one thing he was trying to do. He was trying to use the office constitutionally to knock down unconstitutional legislation, which was what the president should do. He takes an oath to defend the Constitution. This is why I call John Tyler the greatest president in American history. But at the same time, he wasn't an elected king. He was playing marbles. He was vice president and told he's playing marbles on his front porch. Hey, you're going to be president. Oh, gosh, I got to go there. And when it's over, Tyler goes home. Back to Sherwood, to a Sherwood plantation. And that was that. He, of course, got involved in politics again in the 1860s. But Tyler went home. That was that. He retired. And this is what presidents did. They got out of the limelight. They went home. Then you look at the 1850s and look at both Buchanan and Pierce, but more Pierce than Buchanan. Pierce from New Hampshire really restrained in the use of executive power, and people will criticize him for this. Oh, how Franklin Pierce. It's hard to get any worse than Franklin Pierce. You got to go to James Buchanan. But I look at both of these individuals as very well, very much in line with the founder's executive. Restrained use of power. Now, people will criticize Pierce because he didn't see the sectional conflict coming, and he was too pro-South and all these things. He was trying to be a man, a president for the entire Union. And we can talk about what issues were there, and somehow Pierce should have been a 21st century American and understood what was going to happen. Pierce was living in the 19th century. I mean, he was a man of his time. And he had the dominant position of most Americans in the United States, which is why he won the executive branch and why James Buchanan did the exact same thing in 1856, because this is how Americans viewed the executive branch and what they thought policy should be. The majority. Not just Southerners, the majority. Abraham Lincoln was criticized for his abuse of executive power during the war because they thought he was being too much like a king. And when he's out, Andrew Johnson is restrained. He uses the office to veto unconstitutional legislation. Of course, it doesn't work because the Congress has a supermajority, but he's restrained in his use of executive power. You can see this. The reason people don't focus on the late 19th century in terms of presidents is because they weren't out there abusing power. They weren't elected kings. You don't start seeing shades of that until you get to the progressives with Teddy Roosevelt. Teddy Roosevelt is the first in this transition in the 20th century to start looking at the executive branch in a different way. It doesn't mean that there weren't people there that didn't do these things. Of course, as I already mentioned, Lincoln and Jackson and even Washington to an extent. There were people that were saying Washington was smacking a monarchy, and that's because he had Hamilton around in his ear. Washington didn't listen to him. Washington was his own man. Okay, I mean, you can make that argument. Washington was his own man. Hamilton really had no influence. I don't necessarily buy that. Hamilton certainly had influence. But Washington did make his own decisions. I mean, Hamilton couldn't make George Washington do anything. But, that said, and this early 20th century is when you start seeing this shade more towards monarchy, and that coincides, of course, with America becoming more of a world power, with American imperialism ramping up. When you get to the middle of the 20th century, now we've had World War II, and we have the Cold War, and so now you see the presidency as the focal point. And that doesn't mean the presidency wasn't the focal point for American politics before that, but of course, by the time you get to America as a world power, it has to become important. So this is why Jimmy Carter is so interesting. He's within this climate of the Cold War. He's within this late 20th century when the president is supposed to be the king. You had King Franklin, King Roosevelt. You've had presidents before Jimmy Carter who had tremendous power and viewed the office in a way that was very much in line with elected king. Now, Truman, of course, Carter admired Truman, but I think even Truman, as I said in the piece, you know, Truman would go out and he said at one time a letter to his daughter, if he had all the money in the world, he'd buy votes. Is this a guy that's not interested in power and being elected king? Carter never said anything like that. So within this storm of elected monarchy, Carter comes in and carries his own luggage, symbolically, but so what? This is what he's doing. He goes back home to Plains and doesn't do anything else but build houses for Habitat for Humanity and write some books. He's written over 30, scribble out some books. So what? Teaches a Sunday school class. He still walks around town. That's what we should want the president to do. We should want them to go home and stay out of it. So when Carter sticks his nose in things and says stuff, I mean, you expect that nowadays because a reporter comes and asks him. But not just that. I mean, he goes home and he stays out of it, and he doesn't require being an elected monarch. He doesn't look at it that way. As I said on social media at one point, Carter went home. We should expect every president to do this. It's very Jeffersonian. We should expect presidents to have a Jeffersonian view of the executive office, not something else, but this is what we expect. We want the president to come in and part the seas and change the world. But that's not what the presidency was designed to do. In fact, the Congress is the culprit in all this, because the Congress is the one in the body that has allowed the president to get away with this stuff. But Americans now have become so conditioned to wanting a president that's going to go in and shake the foundations of the American political system. We want a king. As Hamilton said in June of 1787, we're going to get there. Might as well go to it now. We've gotten it. And it doesn't matter if it's Obama or Trump. This is what the left wanted, somebody to come in and shake the foundations of politics, and Obama was supposed to do that. The right wanted somebody to come in, Trump was supposed to do that. And we're going to see it again when Trump's out of office, whenever that is, if it's the next election cycle or the one after that. I'm not so certain Trump's going to lose in 2020. He might. But we're going to see it again. Somebody's going to want the president to come in and do everything under the sun. This is exactly what we're getting, because Americans have become so hoodwinked to believe that we should have an elected king. If we had more men like Jimmy Carter, even symbolically downgrading the office. And there were other things. I mean, Carter began the deregulation that Reagan took credit for. Carter was telling people they couldn't have chauffeurs anymore to drive them around. They had to drive themselves to work. I mean, there were all kinds of things Carter was doing that he was trying to say, you know what, we've got to trim down this bureaucracy, this elected monarchy. It can't be like this. And, of course, he had some bad policy decisions, too. No one's saying he didn't. But the idea of downgrading the office was very Jeffersonian. And I think that's something we should at least credit Jimmy Carter with trying to do, whether it happened or not. It obviously was just a reprieve in the storm. It was the eye of the storm, so to speak. But it was something that was at least a worthwhile attempt. And so I slaughter sacred cows. I support people who people shouldn't support, or at least that's what the idea is, quote-unquote, shouldn't support, because I think it's important to be fair and objective in looking at these people. So you can send me all your hate mail now, all your flame mail, because I supported Jimmy Carter. You can do that. I hope you at least read the piece. It's the last Republican president. You can see it on LewRockwell.com, or you can go out to Abbeville Institute and read it there. Just search for that, the last Republican president. You can read it, see what I have to say about it. And it's all about republicanism with a lowercase r, not republicanism with the uppercase r, because that's the key to understanding the American executive. I'll see you next time on The Brion McClanahan Show.